Podcasters.
Thanks a lot, TJ. I'm Raven. I'm joined by none other than the one and only Firebat. How are you doing today? You ready for this series?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Really excited for this series. We got a really good one, actually. Pretty fortunate. We got the only Pirate Warrior in the tournament with Sintalol there. And
he gets to play it.
He gets to play it, yeah.
And both players as well bringing pretty interesting lineups mm-hmm. where both players have brought Freeze Mage, both players have brought Face Hunter, mm-hmm. and then we see the Pirate Warrior on one hand for Sintalol and the Nuzoth Warrior that's actually banned out for Bunny Hopper. So looking at the bans, how do you think these lineups are actually going to face into each other?
Well, just judging by the bans, I think, and the classes that have been brought, I think I would have to kind of favor Bunny Hopper a little bit. Like, all hail the Pirate Warrior, but I think Bunny Hopper's got a little bit of advantage just being able to target out that Warlock deck. But
okay, and we are getting into game one of the second series of the day. It's going to be Bunny Hopper versus Sintalol. And it is going to be Bunny Hopper's Face Hunter versus Sintalol's Freeze Mage. And I don't know about you, but I've played a little bit of this Face Hunter list, or at least something extremely close. And one of the key cards I found to be able to beat out the Freeze Mage is actually going to be an early cat trick. Can actually really get you so far ahead that the 4-2 is kind of awkward to deal with outside of a Frostbolt for the Freeze Mage. And yeah. then you just start stacking up so much damage with that 4-2 from potentially turn 2, just hitting away onto the Freeze Mage and really applying the pressure.
Yeah, and if you get it early enough before any of the freeze effects can come down, it's pretty much a guaranteed 4 damage, yeah. which any guaranteed damage for Face Hunter is really, really good. And off to kind of a slow start on the mulligan here. Bunny Hopper just kind of roping it out a little bit, and we'll have to see what he gets there. But typically speaking, Freeze Mage is just looking for removal, just ways that they can remove every single minion. Because one of the ways that Freeze Mage really pulls ahead and starts winning in this matchup is the fact that Face Hunter has no card draw. They just run out of steam eventually. If you can kill everything they play, you'll probably stabilize at around, 15 life or so, and you get an ice barrier after that, and their hero power is not going to be able to deal enough damage. So the most important part above anything before even ice barriers or ice blocks or Alexstrasza is just removal.
Yeah, you need to just keep the minions down. And like you said, the hero power, although very powerful in general, as it's consistent damage, isn't enough if you can stabilize early mm-hmm. as the mage. But interesting to see Bunny Hopper actually throw away the Kindly Grandmother, as the Freeze Mage can actually just ignore that as a 1-1. It has mm-hmm. like sort of the new style death rattle of a small minion death rattle into a big minion. Yeah. So the Freeze Mage is like, okay, just hit me for one. That's mm-hmm. fine. I'll just freeze it now and again and just never kill it exactly. until the big AoE turns come out. So Bunny Hopper really showing some insight, at least, to how the matchup should be played, and knowing that Grandmother just wouldn't be enough.
Yeah, and the debate here between Fiery Bat or Argent Squire. Bunny Hopper ends up going with Argent Squire. Wants to be able to avoid, just the coin ping removing all of his presence. Because as the mage player, coin ping is a very valid play when faced with a Fiery Bat up against the Face Hunter deck.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you a question, though. Were you a little bit disappointed then that you picked Squire over Fiery Bat?
No, I think it's correct. I think it's correct. Honestly, I think it's fine even for Sintalol here to coin a Doomsayer if he wants. I don't think it's great. I think it would be better to hold off. You get more value a little bit later. But, I don't totally hate it.
Yep. Really would just sort of blow out the turn 2 play from Bunny Hopper. But as we can see, there isn't much of a turn 2 play past hero power, because I feel like although the Fiery Bat definitely helps with providing multiple minions to deal with, as you said to your point, a lot of the time trying to just weave in a hero power is often what you need to do in the matchup to get the extra damage. But Bunny Hopper's going to favor the minion, I guess, just to provide multiple targets for the Sintalol to actually try and deal with.
Sure, yeah, it makes a lot of sense. And there are actually no 2-drop minions in the entire Face Hunter deck, right, besides Kindly Grandmother.
I don't know, because it's so secret heavy, right? So it's just a Kindly Grandmother and then secrets
and then
all the
secrets,
way.
7 secrets in the deck. So if you Doomsayer and then they play Kindly Grandmother, you feel a bit silly.
Yeah, it's like, the plan kind of backfired. I provided more damage for my opponent with a minion that is supposed to clear the board. But going for the Doomsayer into the turn 3 from Bunny Hopper now, and explosive trap. Not really the one you're looking for.
He's got the Hunter's Mark, though, which is what you're looking for. The perfect answer to this, because this way you're able to actually remove the Doomsayer without wasting any damage cards. He's only wasting 1 damage worth of attacks from the Argent Squire, and that's it. He doesn't have to, kill command it or something like that, because if he didn't have the Hunter's Mark, there's no way he wastes the kill command on the Doomsayer. It's just too much precious face damage for the SMR counter.
Yeah, and just using the one damage from the Squire to kill off the Doomsayer, to your point, is, well, you're going to gain more damage going forward from the minions anyway, right? So, do you see Sindelar actually start to draw into some freeze in the form of the Frost Nova? Does have Ice Spire available now, but still, you know, he's got plenty of time, at the moment at least, to just get that Acolyte down and try and make the turns a little bit awkward for Bunnyhopper, because you do want to go highly aggressive, but you obviously can't let the mage just get three draws from the Acolyte in almost any matchup.
Sure.
Does get the Eaglehorn bow, though, so you could choose to equip it and then clear off the Acolyte in one hit, but it just never feels great. You've really got to evaluate what's worth more, just the raw damage or the potential multiple draws from the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I think the damage is worth, like, your board sticking around is worth more, because if you connect with the Fiery Bet this turn, by wasting, you know, three damage of the Eaglehorn bow, you can kind of expect the Fiery Bet to be able to connect again. So it'll make up the loss in damage. You know, you'll be able to push four damage that way rather than, I guess, five if you went face with the Eaglehorn
bow. But the preservation of the minion means it requires removal from the mage, which is then just an additional value.
Yep.
Do you see the Evolved Kobold? Pretty much the common build for Freeze Mage now, with just that absurd amount of additional spell power, just providing insane levels of burst, and really helps the mage in its current form beat out the more controlling and longer matchups like Druid and Warrior. But against Hunter, doesn't normally do too much in terms of the overall battle plan.
Yeah, and Hunter, you can see, is starting to really fizzle out here. Bunny Hopper's starting to kind of run slow on options. We're going to most likely see him start weaving in hero powers, as you said, just trying to get the maximum damage in. And Sentinel's most likely going to be trying to hold on to this coin as long as he can, so he can coin Alexstrasza himself. And he's got to really, you know, balance the timing of this Ice Barrier. Obviously, he wants to be removing the minions as much as possible, but if he gets his health total too low before he plays the Ice Barrier, then he'll get himself in a situation where Bunny Hopper will never have to proc the Ice Barrier, because he can just use Burn out of hand to deal the face damage. So it's getting towards that time where he needs to really start prioritizing getting that Ice Barrier down.
Yeah, the slight frustration to a certain extent for Bunnyhopper is in this Hunter deck, a lot of the time you can get just repeat buffs on the bow and continue its durability because you play so many secrets. It's normally very difficult for an opponent to try and play around all the secrets or to not proc them and still get ahead in the game, but Freeze Mage is one of those decks that doesn't really have to interact with the board too much, on using their own minions at least.
Yeah.
So it's not going to be able to get multiple charges. Bunnyhopper holding onto the bow charge just in case he draws into Catrick to help develop that. Tracking, though, it's a pretty good card.
Tracking is a pretty good card. You could find the Catrick. You could find additional kill commands. You can skip over things that you don't want, like Unleash the Hounds, for example, like cards that will do absolutely nothing in the matchup. So
yeah, probably even to a certain extent, Huntress as well. I mean, it is a 3-4 for 3, so the stat line's pretty reasonable, but in this matchup, when you start starting to get into the turns where you're expecting so much freeze, that it's not going to do too much, does go for the Cat Trick.
Yeah.
And this is one of the best performing cards in this matchup, I think.
For sure, for sure. He's most likely going to be able to get some extra damage from it, but how often is Sintel actually even going to use a spell here? Do you think he's going to really value playing around the Catrick?
It's a real tough one, isn't it? I mean, if he really wants to play around the Catrick, he could just, for example, go Ice Lance into Coin and go into Blizzard. If he really wants to, I don't want to use that coin though.
You got to save the coin for Alex, but he could potentially Ice Lance the face, which will proc the Cat Trick, and then he can Nova and then Doomsayer and just clean everything up that way. You do give your opponent an extra bow charge, though, in that instance, but we do see Sintelul navigating appropriately around all potential secrets. Very well played.
Yeah, and the good thing is that, you know, the additional bow charge is frustrating, but clearing off the Cat in the Hat is, like, super good. Mm-hmm. You know, like, as a 4-2, it just stacks up so much damage, and now kill command available for Bunnyhopper.
Yeah, and he has the Cat in the Hat up right now, so I would think he would just launch one of them for sure. Just get it powered up with the Beast while you got a Beast handy. And not both of them, though, because you still want to be squeezing in hero powers. Mm-hmm. And if you launch both of them, you'll be unable to do so.
Especially because the health is, or at least the 5 health it's going to do, is armor. The armor is never going away, and your kill command is always going to want to connect to face regardless. So why not do it now, right? As you said, squeeze it in. You can whip in a hero power, whip in another secret. And the interesting thing is, although we know it's explosive, Sintelol kind of has to think about what other secrets it could be. So when he does go into Alexstrasza, is it freezing? Because one of the benefits of Alexstrasza in yourself in this matchup is where you have an 8-8 that can just smack your opponent in the face. But if it's freezing, you kind of have to think about it a bit more because you can't really afford to bounce Alexstrasza back to your own hand.
Sure, yeah. Definitely costs 9, so I guess if you hold the coin, maybe. But even then, you can't coin up past 10 mana, so yeah, if it's Freezing Trap, there's no way to play the Alexstrasza. Syntolol gets up to 15 damage in hand, so if he is able to Alexstrasza offensively, he can set up for lethal on turn 10. But oftentimes, you're going to be Alexstrazzing defensively against Face Hunter. And now that you know it's getting towards the time where the Alexstrasza can be played, Bunny Hopper can sort of think about if he wants to try and play around it. But oftentimes, you know, Face Hunter's got one card left. Are they really going to win if there's Alexstrasza? And you can see here, Bunny Hopper does not think he's going to win if there's an Alexstrasza, so he's just going in.
Yeah, exactly. The second you start to try and go sort of halfway between a strategy as Face Hunter, it's like, no, it's called Face Hunter for a reason. You have to go all out aggression and hope, excuse me, and hope for the best. But the only thing missing from Syntolol really is just having that ice block.
Yeah.
If he had ice block, the game would pretty much already be decided, as there's no flare in the deck of the Hunter. So, you know, there's no those shenanigans going to happen. The ice block would be, onto the mage and just provide him enough turns to actually finish the game out. But there isn't ice block available, just a hell of a lot of damage and a huge dragon in hand.
Yeah. Is there a lethal setup here for Syntolol? If we count the damage in his hand plus the Evolved Kobold, right, he could get all of those spells with the Evolved Kobold if he goes Evolved Kobold, Frostbolt, Coin, Forgotten Torch on the face. And that would be 5, 10, and then 16. So he had 26 damage available to him over two turns. So not quite enough to get lethal here. So then we see him go for, still trying to set up for the defensive Alexstrasza, stretching the game out a little bit longer. It was two damage off the lethal setup there. Avoiding attacking with a Novice Engineer, doesn't want to get blown out by something like Snake Trap or something like Explosive Trap.
Yeah, and that's probably the worst draw he could have got in the deck. Is, you know, already got one bow equipped and he's frozen, so it's just every single worst case scenario. But yeah, going back to the Syntolol's hand, the lack of Emperor on the Kobold is really, you know, really hitting him at this point. He's still looking pretty okay, but the idea of the Kobold in general is that you get the Emperor tick on it, which makes the spell damage and the minion itself cheaper to then do truly ridiculous turns.
Yeah. Well, he sets himself up in a good spot. Bunny Hopper doesn't have any sort of one cards that can give him lethal while being frozen there. Not even Leroy Jenkins is enough to do it. And because of the extreme mana cost of Leroy Jenkins, the only like sort of lethal is like Leroy Jenkins, quick shot, hero power with a two-card hand. So the odds of him dying are very low. And Bunny Hopper doesn't have those kind of cards, but needs to start trying to figure out how he's going to play around the Alexstrasza. So I'd expect he holds on to this kill command.
Yeah. I think there's no particular reason to play it this turn. Although, you know, got to be wary of the old Leroy and Leash combo for the for the extra damage with the hero power.
Could happen.
It definitely could happen. This is a tough one. I think this is pretty much just going to be Alexstrasza. You can't afford on 7 when there's a bow to be able to risk the 7 attack. Literally, the Hunter's requirement is 2 damage if you don't Alexstrasza yourself this turn. But now, Bunny Hopper has to think if he's even going to survive his own following turn. So it's pretty much, as you said, hitting the final turns of this matchup where the draws will pretty much decide the game. And Huntress, not what Bunny Hop is after.
No, it's not a burn spell, and he's only got one turn after this to live. Syntolol already queuing up a lot of damage in his hand with the Thalnos double fireball. You know, that's 14 plus the Alexstrasza's 22, so he's 2 off lethal yet again. But that means most likely Bunny Hopper is going to get an extra turn to try and piece together something here. And with another bow equipped already, he's showing, you know, 6, 7, 8 damage available to him. So he's only looking to try and top deck 2 more damage to close out this game if Syntolol is unable to find either ice block, a barrier, or yeah, that's about it, right? Like he needs one of the secrets. There's no sort of damage that's able to get him there.
Yeah, and there is still Horse Rider. There's the Unleash, potentially, depending on what
like
minions are left. Yeah,
here,
exactly.
Yeah.
There's Leroy. There's and 2 quick shots as well. There's a lot of damage potentially available. As we've seen Bunny Hopper struggle with draws, but now as it comes to the game where he might have that one more turn, the fact that he's drawn a lot of dead stuff early on means surely you hit the point where he's going to get a burn spell.
Yeah, and so now Syntolol being a little bit short on damage here, I expect he's going to be, you know, playing his draw minions, then proccing the Explosive Trap to be able to get some free draws here without having to invest the mana into the ping and try and get towards those secrets remaining. Not sure exactly how many cards are left in his deck, but it's getting fairly thin at this point. Freeze Mage does a really good job at cycling cards, and he's got to be hoping he hits either barrier or more than likely, hopefully, block.
Yeah, because even barrier is kind of scary because you've not seen much burn, right?
No quick shots seen yet. You could just very well die.
There we go.
It doesn't choose to drop the Thalnos in there.
Ooh, Flame Strike. It's going to be able to clear off the three for the Huntress, but again, do you feel safe enough with two cards that Bunny Hop has held? What are those cards? That's the question.
Yeah.
Doesn't want a Flame Strike. He's going for the ping. At worst, he can use Alexstrasza on the 3-4. There's the ice block. So now it's Smork life.
Yeah, now the game is all but decided. Now all Sintel has to do is go face and then queue up to launch the fireballs in the next turn. With the Alexstrasza going face, maybe Bunny Hopper can do some sort of cute play where he kills the Alexstrasza, because currently Sintel needs...
Good tracking into Freezing Trap, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, look at that tracking. All the damage he could ever want, all the options. But it's not going to be enough with that secret down.
Well, he can hope that the secret's barrier, right? He can go kill command, quick shot, both to the face and hero power. And if it's barrier, he wins the game. There's only one barrier left in the deck and two ice blocks left in the deck. So odds are it's ice block. So that's kind of risky there. And then the other risk he could try and go for is trying to kill the Alexstrasza and then bowing face. And if it's ice block, he doesn't actually even pop the block this turn. So then he gives Sintel two turns to try and put together the damage to end it. Yeah, so I would suggest, you know, just going face, hoping that it's an ice barrier. Go with the quick shot, kill command, hero power, and see if that ends the game, because it's very unlikely that your Freeze Mage opponent with this thin of a deck is unable to string together a victory in two turns.
Yeah, holding this many cards and knowing that a lot of them have been held onto for a long time, even knowing the coins available for even extra potential damage. Okay.
He is going to clear the Alexstrasza, though. He's got the read that... Sintel doesn't have the damage. We saw Sintel use an Ice Lance earlier, a Frostbolt earlier, one Forgotten Torch. So, you know, he very well could not have the damage. And we can see here in his hand he does not have the damage.
But he's got the time.
He's got the time. Yeah.
All the time in the world.
Yeah, he's got the time here. If he wants to just play Emperor and then set up to do 2 8 damage fireballs in the following turn, right? So just Emperor and ping face, and then next turn he can go Evolved Kobold, Coin Fireball, Fireball for 16 damage.
Yeah, I think I'd go for that.
And it looks fancy too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Seems pretty good. You can fit in all three spells, the two fireballs and the kobold next turn for a total of 9 mana. Yeah. Kind of ridiculous.
Yeah, and then coin ping, 17 damage available to him.
Yeah, Snake Trap, not the one to save him. Not today, at least, anyway. And Snake Trap really not being what he needs. Doesn't even be able to proc the... he does proc the block just about with the addition of the Cloaked Huntress. But as we can see, even if there wasn't the damage this turn, the second block is available anyway. So Sintelol could just, as Freeze Mage does, just continue to buy more time.
Does look like he may be BMing here with a loot hoarder a little bit. Oh, no, he's just testing for the snipe. Okay, yeah. Of course.
Yeah, I didn't think there was a snipe in the deck, though, right?
Nope.
Don't think so, no.
But you can never be too cautious.
The thing is, if you can play around, you know, naturally and mechanically just play around things all the time, you just should, right? Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's going to be Sintelol taking the first game, so off to a good start getting the win with the Freeze Mage as well.
They're kind of the expected outcome, though, you know. That's how that matchup goes. We talked about it a little bit before it even started, you know. The Face Hunter just doesn't have the steam to keep up with the life hit gain of Freeze Mage. Just that, as long as they are able to get, you know, decent removal in the beginning, not even just great removal, just their hero power is oftentimes good enough to slow down Face Hunter enough, and then they just get one gain 8 life with the ice barrier, and they're usually just out of range.
Yeah, and it was a really tough match there for Bunny Hopper, but we'll see if he can even it up right after this. Welcome back to the second game between Bunny Hopper and Sintelol. We just saw Sinter take out win with the Freeze Mage versus the Face Hunter in a pretty convincing fashion. It was kind of close towards the end because there was no ice block available until quite late. But in general, the matchup went, as you said, like, you know, how it's really going to go overall. And it does leave Sintelol with just his Warrior, his Warlock, and his Shaman left versus the full lineup of Bunny Hopper. So Bunny Hopper's got a bit of a tough climb to go, I feel, with these lineups.
Yeah, maybe so. He still has the ability to kind of clutch on Sintelol's Warlock as I can't expect Sintel to have an easy time with the Warlock against Bunny Hopper's lineup, so that's really going to be the story of the series as we go on. But the Shaman Mirror coming up now, and this one's really anybody's game. It's hard to say one player has too much of an edge. You know, if we look at the specific deck lists, Bunny Hopper does have the Harrison Jones, which can make a huge difference, but Sintel also has the Harrison Jones. So almost card for card identical. One of the big differences is Bunny Hopper has an Argent Horse Rider over the Bloodlust, and Sintelil has a Ragnaros over a Manatide Totem.
Yeah.
So just a few changes here and there, but like really only one or two card differences between the lists, so you can expect it to play out really, really similarly, and whoever kind of gets ahead first usually in these kind of Shaman matchups takes a big snowball lead, and then the other side swipes back with a Storm first, and then they build up a board, and then the other side storms, and then, you know, kind of trade storms back and forth, and then the first player to kind of run out of storms is usually the one that kind of gets rolled over.
Yeah, as soon as you can build the board up and your opponent doesn't have an answer to it, you're just so far ahead instantly. You can gain so much extra damage. And look at the opening hands here. Bunny Hopper not looking too bad. Has the choice of coining out the Golem, which is so commonly the play
on
turn
one.
And he has the follow-up of Spirit Claws, which is the important one. He can just go straight in with that one drop being overloaded.
And he gets the overload out of the way for his three drop as well with this line of play. He's able to go coin two into one and then into three. Whereas if he went one, he would go two and then coin three, and it's a little bit more awkward because your Spirit Claws aren't actually accomplishing anything. So this just is a much more smooth way to develop that curve. Meanwhile, Sinto on the other side, it's not looking pretty. It's not looking pretty for the Prince of Underground Hearthstone.
No, when the matchup is so forced around the early game and getting ahead, having double Mana Tide Totem, Rag, and Azure Drake, not really what you're after when your opponent's curving as well as Bunny Hopper is now. So it's going to be reliant on Bunny Hopper really, you know, making as much impact he can and getting as much advantage out of being able to start off quickly versus Sintelol's relatively low beginning.
And if there's one way to leverage an advantage, it's a Manatide Totem. Because if your opponent has no minions on the board, that means they have to use a card or a removal spell from hand to answer a Manatide Totem instead of being able to trade, you know, as Bunny Hopper just did, a minion in the field, just killing it for free. So you end up pulling ahead in cards because the Manatide gains you a card and then costs a card from your opponent to remove it. So you pull ahead in one card. And that's assuming they kill it on the first turn. If they don't have an answer, you just slowly start, you know, walking away with the game, then jogging away with the game. Then all of a sudden, you're running away with the game, and it gets out of control really quick.
Yeah, it's an extremely frustrating card to come down in this situation. I hate it.
It's just not fun for new players, right?
It can't attack me. It's not doing any damage,
but it's killing me.
Yeah. It's like, this is horrible.
It just stares you down.
Yeah.
Having double Totem Golem here, though, could be a great turn for Sintelil just to kind of overload himself, but get himself a huge presence on the board to try and fight back against this Manatide Totem.
Yeah, and even with the overload from the Totem Golems, he still has three mana available, so if he draws like Lightning Storm, he can still play it and potentially snap back the turn like that as well. So, as you said, not too bad. Some pretty chunky minions there for Sintelil. Bunny Hopper's turn to now try and answer. He does have Lightning Bolt, and if he could roll Spell Power, it would be pretty nice.
I am on the game plan here. If I was in Bunny Hopper's shoes, save the cheerleader, save the world. So just protect the Manatide Totem for dear life. I would use a Tempo Hex here and Lightning Bolt plus the Spirit Claws to remove both of my opponent's minions. Just they've shown that they have no answer for the Manatide, and just keep it trucking and just generate card advantage. But Bunny Hopper goes with a different line of play, tries to get that... maybe Spell Power Totem was obviously what he's looking for, so the Lightning Bolt would be able to line up, and then he can trade the Spirit Claws plus the Totem Golem in. Or even Taunt Totem's also in his favor, so it's like a 50-50 totem roll there to be able to protect the Manatide, which at the end of the day, if you win that 50-50, that's absolutely nuts, because you get to save very precious resources in that of Hex, which doesn't have the most amount of targets in the matchup, but we do know Sinto is running, you know, one extra threat in his deck, and that is Ragnaros, which is something you're going to want to turn into a frog.
Yeah, exactly. And what this does as well, I don't mind this play in general, because even if you whiff on the totem, well, if this Totem Golem kills the Manatide, kind of sucks because you lose the card draw, but it's leaving up a Totem Golem and a Tunnel Trog. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you're still going to be quite ahead, sure. And you can leverage the power you've gained that turn to kill the Totem Golem and then get ahead again. So, Sinterlore going for his second mana time of the game to again just try and continue into the card draw, yeah. Be able to pull ahead in the match. And you know what? Lightning Storm's a pretty good draw as well. Yes. It's probably one of the best draws you could get. As you said, the matchup normally revolves around who can clear and then not be cleared in return, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah, so usually you don't want to be the first one storming, though, because if you storm first, then your opponent storms second, then you would storm third, and then your opponent storms fourth, and then you have to storm, you know, the last time.
It's too many storms for me, Fiber. I've lost track already.
And then your opponent storms the sixth time and then takes the board back, and you don't have the seventh storm.
Yeah. It can get a little
and
bit
And you just run out of board clears, and you just get plowed over at that point.
Yeah, and we see the thing from below come down again, which is just yet another card that helps Shaman flood the board so quickly. It's kind of crazy. And this is super awkward, because with that thing from below, there's no great way to clear it off now, because even with the spell power Storm, it's not going to be enough, even if it high rolls, to be able to kill the 5 health.
There's like the Hail Mary Fire Elemental. Tell him you're going to Storm and just hit it on the 5/5 and say go. And then next turn, try and get the Blood Mage Thalnos plus Totem and hope maybe you get the Spell Power Totem so you don't have to high roll as much, and then play the Lightning Storm out there to try and get the full board sweep. You would signal that you're playing the Storm, but it would be one of the only ways that you can kind of set up for a full board clear here. Other than that, you can just kind of play the Drake and ride off the top of your deck. So Cinto doesn't really want to signal the fact that a Storm's coming and is just going to be, you know, developing a pretty high power minion. Forces an answer from Bunny Hopper, of course, and maybe Bunny Hopper trades the 5/5 min because it's a juicy value trade and gets kind of punished for that. But I doubt Bunny Hopper's going to trade that 5/5, and I think Storm is very much on his mind and he wants to try and play around it to the best of his ability.
Yeah, as you said, it's the only way you can really fall behind or get ahead in the game is the huge AoE and leverage that the Shaman has available. And mm-hmm. Bunny Hopper now has the choice of either going a little bit heavier onto the board with bigger minions, but without being able to bank on the initial Thunderbluff value. Whenever you play Thunderbluff, one, you want totems down, and two, you want to be able to hero power the same turn as well. So I imagine we're just going to see quite a light turn from Bunny Hopper now and just continue to pile on the pressure that he's already got.
It's going
to
be a pretty aggressive turn. We got this Flametongue Totem.
Okay.
We got this Argent Horse Rider. You can trade in both of these totems, play around Storm as much as possible. He didn't even face tank the Drake. He just got rid of the totem straight up to play around Storm as aggressively as he possibly could and push as much damage as possible while doing so.
Oof. Not the best reaction from Sinterlore, though. He's
he knows he's...
That was a lot of damage. Yeah, damn it.
he knows he's screwed when he saw that play. That is a beautiful play from Bunny Hopper. Just navigates perfectly around Storm and basically sets up a checkmate against Sinterlore. There's not much he can do in this situation. Now he needs some sort of Feral Spirits turn, and he just doesn't have it in the cards.
Yep, that was a pretty impressive play overall from Bunny Hopper there, just really identifying exactly what he needed to do to get ahead. And just pressuring Sinterlore out of the game. And to be honest, other than the lack of AoE we saw in that game, that was pretty much how the Shaman matchup goes, right?
One player pulls ahead, and the other player's got to have the AoE to take it back, and Sinterlore wasn't able to kind of make that AoE come together quick enough. And when he did finally make it come together, Bunny Hopper was right on it. He knew it was there. He knew, this is how I'm going to... If I'm going to lose, it's going to be because of Lightning Storm. How do I play around it to the best of my ability? And just did that, and that was that.
Yeah, pretty much. So that does even it up. Bunny Hopper versus Sinterlore 1-1. And now there's going to be the Hunter, Mage, and Druid of Bunny Hopper versus the Warrior, Warlock, and Shaman of Sinterlore. So a nice widespread mix of classes here. It's going to be interesting to see. I mean, I don't know about you. I'm just waiting for the Pirate Warrior.
I'm definitely hyped about the Pirate Warrior.
Can someone just message Sinterlore and be like, lock it in now. We want to see it now. We've waited long enough. We've seen the deck list. They got announced. This is Series 2 of the day. And I just want to see the Pyro get played.
It's a weird rock, paper, scissors situation that I got going on. Because, like, Sinterlore's Warlock beats Bunny Hopper's Druid, but loses to the Mage and the Hunter. And then Sinterlore's Pirate Warrior most likely loses to the Druid, beats the Mage, and beats the Hunter. And then his Shaman loses to the Mage, beats the Druid, and loses to the Hunter. So he's got to kind of line these up absolutely perfectly. And Bunny Hopper on the same side, obviously the reverses of those. So they both have, like, one deck that's good against two of their opponent's decks and bad against the other, and so on and so forth. So they really need to get him to line up right to have favorable matchups and favorable outcomes in this. And, you know, in Conquest, the key order is totally random. So you have to kind of make reads on your opponent or roll the dice or whatever to try and get him to line up correctly.
Yeah, I think what is important is if one of the players can actually win an unfavored matchup, then suddenly the whole series changes. You know, that is so much of an advantage, which I think is the main story of Conquest, is if you can get that unfavored win, your whole lineup suddenly looks so much better and you're much more likely to win the series. But we are going to get into Game 3. No more waiting around. It's going to be Syntolol versus Bunny Hopper, and Syntolol's, he got my message.
Yeah, he got the Pirate Warrior.
He's gone straight for this
up.
Pirate Warrior versus Bunny Hopper's Face Hunter. So this should not be the longest game of Hearthstone in history.
It should be quite quick. Typically speaking, Pirate Warrior in the past has been the most favored deck against Hunter. But Hunter has always been the mid-range variant. It hasn't been his face variant. His face variant has been kind of cutting edge and new as far as Hunter prospects go. So it'll be interesting to see how it lines up here. I don't have too many stats or familiarities with this kind of matchup.
It's not a matchup we've really cast or witnessed too often, at least.
So it'll be pretty cool. I have to imagine that the weapons will actually allow you to kind of pull ahead on the board. And as long as you're able to navigate the secrets kind of effectively, I think the Warrior has to have a slight edge just because it's a face deck versus a face deck, and the Warrior has better weapons for gaining tempo with Fiery War X and whatnot, and then also just has higher quality minions going forward, because typically speaking, the deck versus face deck pans out is both decks really want to go face, but they end up having to trade with their early minions with each other so that neither can kind of start snowballing going face. And then the deck that's just slightly slower usually pans out ahead because they have more value going forward. And we can see already, you know, Syntolol having Corcoran elites and whatnot, whereas the Face Hunter deck kind of stops its curve at three, basically, with the Huntress, and then just has Leeroy at the top end chilling.
Yeah, there's not enough instant effect in the Face Hunter deck versus the Warrior. And also, one of the frustrations you can have in this matchup as the Hunter is it's kind of awkward to get Catrick proc'd because there's just not that many spells that Warrior can play. And also, even if they have a turn where they, you know, we can see upgrade in hand, right? But they can just happily just not upgrade if there's a secret live and just not even give the cat in the hat to the opponent and then just force it through sheer minion pressure. So I think Warrior is favored-ish in this matchup. And choosing not to go for the Hunter Hero Power from the Finley there, going for the Druid.
Yeah. You definitely want a board control Hero Power in this matchup. It's you're scrappy. You're trading minion on minion combat all day or day in this matchup. So I really like the choice of either going for Druid or Rogue, but I'm interested that he goes with Druid instead of with Rogue. With the upgrade in hand, he could have had a potentially really strong turn just going Dagger, Coin, Upgrade if there's no secret to buff this Secret Keeper.
Yeah, I think the idea is sort of that there's the choice for the instant payout of going for the Rogue with the upgrade versus the long term of Druid just being better for everything, because there's only weapons
if you
in
draw
the deck.
Weapons,
and you always do want to upgrade the actual weapon that you've got versus just a Rogue weapon. So not looking too bad. Kind of Grandmother again. It's just
there we go, and he top decks the weapon. He's rewarded for his decision of going with the Druid Hero Power. So I think most likely we're going to see the Nazoth's First Mate plus the upgrade come in to kill the Secret Keeper before it can get buffed by any of those, you know, seven secrets in the deck. And then Finley not trading with the Grandmother because you don't want to deal with that 3-2 right now. Nobody's got time for that swing to the face.
Yeah, and the benefit is when the Grandmother does trade in, well, he's already got the weapon to just kill off the 3-2 anyways. He said that he's going to be more board-centric and about keeping the board clear of the minions. And now this is looking pretty rough for Bunny Hopper. He has sort of reactive quick shots if he needs them to take down some of the minions. Maybe not quite yet, of course, because there's not too much pressure on the board. But with double Corcoran and Frothing Berserker, they're all minions that Bunny Hopper will have to deal with, because that is a lot of damage. And now Mortal Strike as well. So Syntolol in a position to just get very aggressive when he needs to.
Yeah, I mean, he can even play defensively here with the Mortal Strike if he wants to as well. You know, just removing the minion with the Mortal Strike in his weapon and keeping Finley. He can go for a Frothing buff to be able to contest. He most likely suspects that his opponent does not have many secrets in their hand since they didn't play any, and they all cost zero right now for them.
Yeah, and also, even this Frothing doesn't directly kill off the Huntress on the trade, but Hunter struggles to deal one damage, and Warrior really doesn't when he's just got Finley already on the board. His weapon deals two, but who cares? You know, that's fine.
It's good enough
to be able to clear it up. And he can just Corcoran if he really needs to. But yeah, this is looking really good for Syntolol. Just actually put himself in a really strong position that Bunny Hopper's kind of awkwardly got to try and deal with, and nothing looks great. And when you hit the point of leaving a Frothing Berserker on the board, it's a very, very scary moment indeed.
definitely, definitely very scary. So we see Bunny Hopper debating here whether or not he wants to trade into the Finley. He develops that Argent Square, so he is going to have a minion out there to be able to finish off the Frothing Berserker for the next turn when he chooses to, you know, trade in one of these Cloaked Huntresses into it. So he's able to, you know, establish an ability to get that one damage in, which is really important, but... yeah. I think I like... That is a really tough call where to go with that Huntress. I don't know if killing the Finley is all that relevant. I may have liked to say go face there, but who can really tell? It's a really difficult decision because it is all about the board control. You do want to be protecting your Argent Squire from potentially dying, because if that Argent Squire does die, suddenly you're going to have to trade both Cloaked Huntresses into the Frothing or something like that, and that will not feel good, or trade one in and quick shot it, and you don't want to have to do that.
Yeah, just too many resources involved there to be able to just do that extra damage to the Frothing Berserker, but Frothing Berserker is a threat on its own now, and with the Dread Corsair, Sinsalor could potentially try and just guard this Frothing Berserker anyway. Getting the 3-3 taunt on the board is going to be pretty huge, as again, there's just the damage just isn't there into the Frothing, and this is starting to, you know, get a little bit scary, where Bunny Hopper might just have to double quick shot this turn just to be able to slow the board down, but he's going to continue to fall behind because, you know, there's double Corcoran and Mortal Strike still available. We just see the value of that Nezoth First Mate weapon, the hook, with an upgrade is just so much durability to just be able to keep attacking turn after turn after turn.
And yeah, Bunny Hopper here, it has the ability to, you know, empty his hand and get some value off these quick shots, like you said, with the double quick shots, since he was able to pick up a trap. And I think it's really important to be able to keep your minions around, so I like protecting that Huntress as much as possible. I think you just drop the freezing trap in there, play a quick shot on both of the minions, and trade your Argent Squire into the Frothing to finish it off, and hopefully find another trap off the draw.
Yeah, I like it, because you could think about trying to freeze the Frothing Berserker.
But the second a charge comes down,
you're in major, major trouble, and it's not going to be unheard of for the charge to get down by now. You know, there's been plenty of turns to draw into them. And also, Bunny Hopper knows that Sinsalor's been holding on to a couple of cards as well, so the odds on a charge happening are far, far too risky. Does get the draw, and like I said, we'll be looking for a secret of some kind just to get the most value out of this turn.
Yeah, the most likely cards in a Pirate Warrior's hand when he's holding on to cards are... either Arcanite Reaper, which we can kind of assume that it's most likely not, since Sintalo did have the coin, and you may have seen him just coin Arcanite Reaper face a little bit earlier, or something like Mortal Strikes or Leroy Jenkins. So that's got to be on Bunny Hopper's mind. Typically speaking, like Corcoran Elite isn't a card that gets stuck in your hand sitting around for a while, but just kind of interesting situation that that happened to be the case this game. But dealing with the traps is not easy to do. There are seven of them. It could be an array of things, from, you know, snakes to freezing explosive cat tricks. So it's very difficult to deal with every single trap. And
since I was like, yeah, that Corcoran got bounced, this is a problem. And now he's probably got a pretty decent idea that it is going to be cat trick. Ooh. And the problem is, if it because he's going to presume it is cat trick at this point, because I think the odds are in proccing most of them, except maybe snakes.
It's either cat or snakes at this point. Yeah. So it's between those two traps for the options for it. And a cat trick probably isn't too much of a big deal.
You think? I think on this health total, just an additional 4 damage out of nowhere.
You're never going to proc the cat trick until your opponent's just dead.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, if you proc it early, then you're going to die.
Yeah.
So it's something that you really have to think about. He's just going to go face himself. He does have Mortal Strike and Heroic Strike available, and that stacks up to quite a lot of damage, especially if Bunny Hopper continues to push Sintalol's health down. Yeah, like, this has just turned into just, okay, who can smoke the quickest?
Well, you're definitely going to be killing this Corcoran Elite. He's actually dead if he doesn't remove this Corcoran Elite. He will be dead to the upgrade Heroic Strike coin Mortal Strike play if he just chooses to ignore the Corcoran Elite. So he has to remove it here, and I don't think you're getting any more value out of this Hunter's Mark than that. And preserving your health total is very important as the Hunter, because that means you're going to be able to squeeze in more Hunter Hero powers, which means more damage in the long run. And it does set up lethal for the next turn. Sets up 11 damage, and your opponent can only armor for 1 because they have their Druid Hero power. And it's pretty much impossible for your opponent to deal 15 damage right now. They're at least very unlikely. They need, like, double Heroic Strike. Nope, that doesn't even do it. Yeah, it's very, very hard for them to deal that amount of damage, if not impossible. So really like the play by Bunny Hopper there, identifying that he can still set up lethal while clearing the minion.
Yep, so now Sinclair has to make the really tough decision of, does he have to just Mortal Strike down the Huntress?
Well, he can't. Cat in the Hat. And oh, yeah. That'll be that.
Ah, good rhyme. I like it.
It could be snakes, though. So
it could be snakes, so that's very risky. If it's not snakes, you lose. Well, or at least you put yourself in a position that it's very likely that you're going to lose.
So what kills him in this spot? We know Leroy kills him, and that's what's in the hand. But it could be literally anything in the hand. If it's the bow, he's still alive. If it's Kill Command, he's still alive. Both quick shots have been used. So literally the only card that kills him if he ignores the minion is Leroy. So I think it's very likely that he's just going to try and set up his own lethal here, mm-hmm. play around Cat in the Hat, and...
taking the highest chance here, actually just not, you know, his highest win rate chance, basically, mm-hmm. because as you said, there is only Leroy available. But we can see that Bunny Hopper does have it. Sentinel blatantly not happy.
Yeah.
Kind of glad the mics are muted.
Yeah, it's like, we can't kind see of cursing them. There a little bit. Huh?
Maybe just a splash, but Bunny Hopper is going to take the game and move ahead in this series. Sentinel got off to a pretty reasonable start, but Bunny Hopper doing quite well, and that Pirate Warrior, although quite close, just not close enough.
I thought it was going to take it there. I thought it had like a really early lead. You know, the 1-1 Pirate there, being able to get that Rusty Hook and then being able to upgrade that was absolutely huge for the board control. But just trying to deal with those freezing traps. Those traps are absolutely brutal at slowing down the tempo and got the better of the Pirate Warrior.
Yeah, it's a really good game for Bunny Hopper there. Going to take that win. But we'll see if the Pirate Warrior has a chance to take another game for Sinterlal right after this. We are back continuing the series of Bunny Hopper versus Sinterlal. We just saw Bunny Hopper take a very close game with the Face Hunter versus the Pirate Warrior. So he now only has his Freeze Mage and his Druid left to win with, whereas Sinterlal has most of his lineup.
Most of his lineup.
Yeah, pretty much most of his lineup
at
this point.
He's got the Pirate Warrior, the Zoo, and the mid-range Shaman. So he's got his work cut out for him for sure. He's got to try and make sure he can get that Zoo to line up against the Druid. So I expect him most likely to be, queuing that up and trying to 3-0 the Druid at this point.
Yeah, I think it's a definitely valid strategy here. We are going to get into the game now, and it is going to be Bunny Hopper on his Druid versus Sinclair's Pirate Warrior again. I'm kind of glad he's just gone for the Pirate Warrior.
Sure.
Just want to see more of this deck, see if it can actually get a win, because I think it's like the make or break when you bring a deck like this to a tournament this prestigious as well. This is literally 8 of the best players in Europe fighting it out for their spot to get into BlizzCon, and Sinclair's took a very unconventional deck, and I think a lot of his performance is going to rely on the performance of this deck overall.
Yeah, there's not a lot of stats out there about Pirate Warrior, so I'm not sure if he's doing like his own stats or something like this, but like against Druid, typically on ladder, you have a decent win rate if you look at just the generic stat pool, but no one on ladder ever expects it to be Pirate Warrior.
Yeah.
So that like factors into that sample size a lot, especially if you do a lot of your testing through ladder. And Bunny Hopper here has full information. He knows it's Pirate Warrior. He knows all 30 cards of this Pirate Warrior deck. So that's why we see him keeping things like Wrath, which Druid typically never does against Warrior. So you got to imagine that the stats that Sinclair probably has are maybe a little bit skewed because of just how unique the deck is. And that could play a big factor in to see if, you know, is the deck actually a legit tournament deck or not.
Yeah, and also Druid as a class at the moment has a lot of options available to actually just heal.
Oh, yeah.
With a lot of the time, there's potentially 2 Feral Rages, there's 2 Raven Idols to go into more Feral Rages or go into Moonblade, Healing Touch. You know, there's so many options that you can, so many options that you can just gain additional life.
And then there's 2 cards that give taunt off the spells as well. So you're looking at like 6 spells that are super beneficial for you at that point. And it's just absolutely crazy. Your odds of actually hitting one are pretty good.
Yeah, and Pirate Warrior can just run out of juice. So if you just don't die for long enough, they're not going to ever really be able to put enough damage together to actually kill you. As long as you can keep the minion pressure down. And again, as you said, the hold on the Wrath, now he has even Moonfire drawn into a swipe now. There's a lot of options just to reduce the potential like high aggression from this deck early on.
Bunny Hopper's entire hand right now is removal and card draw to draw more removal. Like, it's pretty much what you
plan.
Want. It's like Pirate Warrior has very limited amount of minions. How do you stop them? Well, you can heal, which is what he's got, and then you can remove all their minions, then you can draw cards to remove the rest of their minions. And if you do that, I can't imagine you losing that matchup. And we do see him go with the Feral Rage for the heal there. I really like that because the 3-drop you're expecting to come out of the Pirate Warrior deck is almost always just going to be Frothing Berserker. That's their typical 3-drop. Or sometimes I guess they'll play the Dread Corsair there since it is reduced. But all of that still just dies to swipe anyway. So might as well, while you got the mana, just get the healing involved.
Yeah, I think if he didn't have the swipe available, then he just would have saved the Feral Rage as a potential answer to that 3-drop. But yeah, if you have the swipe, then damn right you want the health. And it, you know, he's going to move into turns where he can just nourish into 3 more cards. And so far, he's under very little pressure. So he's got the time to nourish as well. It's kind of looking pretty good for Bunny Hopper early on. And Cyndaquil with, you know, Corsair, Leeroy... He has got the weapon buffed a little bit, so even the Fire War Axe draw isn't that crazy. Mortal Strike, normally a spell you want to use to actually just finish your opponent, so he's got his late game.
Yeah, 50% of his hand is late game finisher cards, and now 66% of his hand is late game finisher cards, so it's not really the position you want to be in. And he doesn't have the Arcanite Reaper, which is just the power card that makes the deck. Having that card on 5 increases your win rate, like, a huge proportion with Pirate Warrior, and not having that for turn 5 is potentially going to be super painful unless he's able to top deck it. And both of his upgrades have been used to very, very mediocre effect. Yeah. As little effect as double upgrade could possibly be used for, almost, just because of how, you know, the hand ended up panning out. Typically speaking, you want to upgrade a bigger weapon than the Battle Axe.
Yeah, and Bunny Hopper actually going for the ramp with the nourish there to be able to just drop Ragnaros if he really wants this following turn. The frustration is Argent Horse Rider, kind of an annoying minion to play Ragnaros into.
He got the Moonfire.
Yeah, he does have Moonfire to peel the shield if he really needs, or to potentially kill the minion off after based on the Rag hit. But kind of frustrating, but still being able to just drop Rag when you're on 28 health on turn 5.
Oh, you get
double Moonfire, guaranteed the 8 to face, so do I.
You just start clocking him. Yes. You know, Pirate Warrior is really good at going face, but I think Ragnaros has got Pirate Warrior beat.
Like, yeah, a little bit. Especially when there's no executes in this deck either, so there's literally just no good way. And Cyndaquil not happy about this Ragnaros at all, and I kind of I feel him on this one. There's just no good way to deal with it. He actually just cannot. Can he even kill it next turn? No, he just can't kill it at all. There's just nothing good he can do.
Well.
Is this the Leeroy Nazoth's first mate kill one of the whelps with the weapon?
Kill one of the whelps, try and get Leeroy to connect for 12, I guess?
If Leeroy for 28 at this point.
Yeah.
He just needs Leeroy to just keep connecting. Go on Matrix on the Ragnaros and keep dodging that. Oh. So never mind. There's Living Roots. Don't you worry.
And now the Raven Idol can even, you know, go minion if he wants to so that he can develop behind this and clock faster. Or you can still just take spell and look for any of those more heals or taunts, what have you.
All right, these are not the best options he could get. I wouldn't mind Soul of the Forest just because it just keeps minions on the board. Worst case scenario, if these guys get cleared up, he can actually just trade in the Dragonling now and just gain a 2-2. And then if Rag dies, well, you gain another minion, which is just going to help continue to trade and continue to stabilize your life total.
Got him.
Yeah.
As weird as it sounds, I think minion was actually a little bit better there for Bunny Hopper, just because you still have the ability to get some heals and taunts, but just the ability to speed up the clock by a turn on average is more important than the ability to hit a heal.
Yeah, I think the best thing would have actually been a nourish from spell, you know, to just draw the following turn, or the same turn even, and then just carry on getting ahead on the opponent. And the second War Axe, I mean, yeah, good. I think Cyndaquil heard me. I said second War Axe, he just shook his head, and it's like, yep, I understand that feeling. And there's honestly just not a lot he can do at this point.
No, I can't imagine a string of draws that allows him to win this game. 12, 15, 18. Like, the most you can expect him to do is about, like, 18, right? Like, he can swing the War Axe this turn, and then Rag and such hits him in the face, and then he dop decks another Mortal Strike because he's only got one turn to live, right? Because of the amount of damage coming in. He's facing down 10 damage a turn, so he can't armor outside of range. He could maybe Mortal Strike a 2-2, and then if he gets a minion and Rag hits the minion and your opponent draws dead a few turns, maybe that's the line of play you got to go for, but you can't get lethal over 2 turns. So if you're not clearing anything, you're not winning by clocking. It's actually impossible. So I think you have to Mortal Strike the 2-2.
Okay, it looks like was Mortal Strike used there? I'm not sure.
No, he's just trying to armor out of it. So he's going to experience 10 face damage, and then he's going to hope for a minion, and then he's...
he's going to hope for a miracle.
He's likely going to experience another 10 face damage, and it's not going
to
be pretty.
Sintel visibly upset as well. He appears instantly. I've not seen him on camera before, to be honest, so this is the first time I've seen him play in a game, as Bunny Hopper does clear that up off the back of the rag, and he just seems visibly unhappy, whereas there are a lot of players that even if games go, you know, that far against you, they're just very like, right, okay, you know.
Yeah, this is like his first like big stage appearance, right? He's from Underground Hearthstone. He plays the Open Cups off camera, so he's from the shadows, and this is his time in the spotlight. So maybe he's cracking a little bit under the pressure, experiencing some tilt, maybe some salt for how the way his draws have been kind of going, and that can hurt you at the end of the day.
Yeah, and to be honest, you know, there are games that go like that, whereas Bunny Hopper
was pretty
much
tough for him to win.
Yeah,
right,
that
there
was pretty much just a done deal from turn four.
I think there was some questionable usage with the upgrades. I don't think you can actually, you know, beat Druid by limiting yourself that much power on your upgrade. Like, just because that's such a powerful card in the matchup for being able to gain extra value trading with your War Axe or what have you. So I think being so aggressive with it early on maybe kind of hurt him a little bit. But I don't think he was winning that game regardless of what happened. Like, the draws just lined up so well for Bunny Hopper. He just had everything he wanted. Like, we just saw from the starting hand, removal, heal, and draw. Like, there you go.
Yeah, exactly. It's exactly what he needed. I think the upgrade needed to be used for the durability value on an Arcanine
Reaper.
To be able to, you know,
or a War Axe, because
exactly.
Druid has the heal, and you know they have the heal. You're not going to be able to rush him down with a 2-4 weapon.
Exactly.
It's just not going to happen. And you saw he was able to, like, draw into Fiery War Axes and stuff later, and he was like, well, I can't equip the Fiery War Axe because I have this useless 2-4 weapon that I'm still swinging with, and now I don't have the upgrade to upgrade the Fiery War Axe into, which would have been a 4-3, which numbers kind of line up a little bit better there.
Yep, so we are getting into Game 5, and Bunny Hopper only needs one more to progress into the semi-final of this European Last Call tournament. Sintelol has a long road to go if he wants to take this series as a whole, and he is continuing with the Pirate Warrior, and this hand looks a little bit better, mainly because of that card sat in the middle there, as we mentioned before.
It's so important to have that card, especially against Freeze Mage. Freeze Mage is not going to put up taunts. They don't have really great ways to interact with the Arcanine Reaper. They can try and freeze your face, but that's going to be clocking them. That is a really fast clock coming out of the gate for Sintelol. And he's got a nice curve leading up to it, right? He's got the Dread Corsair on 3, into the Corcoran on 4, into the Reaper on 5. And meanwhile, Bunny Hopper, not too much going on in his camp. No too great a place. It looks like he's debating going for the Coin Ping, just trying to stop all of the incoming damage as fast as possible. We do know Bunny Hopper's Freeze Mage list, only one Ice Barrier. And that card is absolutely crucial in this matchup.
Yeah, it's kind of tough as well, because it's not as if you can get away with it. It looks like the Ice Barrier has pretty much been, the second one has been swapped out for Flame Strike. And that's great in some matchups.
Not,
but Warrior normally just ends the game by hitting you in the face for like 12 with a weapon. So the lack of the second Ice Barrier could be huge. And again, as you said, this curve is actually just filling out a hell of a lot better for Sintelol this game.
Yeah, that is a nut curve. That is pretty much the best Pirate Warrior hand you are going to see of all time.
Ever.
It's really just something else, man. And we do see Sintelol is going to go for the Bloodsail Raider here. And the reason why he does this is because both plays develop a 3-3, because the taunt is pretty much irrelevant against Freeze Mage, especially against a player that has no minions developed on the board. And then this means later on, when Sintelol does play the Arcanine Reaper for 5 mana, he can then play the Dread Corsair for 0 mana, whereas he would be unable to play, you know, the Bloodsail Raider for 0 mana on that turn. So it fills out his curve even better.
Yeah, and also with the Raider, it might gain a lot more attack later from the Arcanine Reaper.
But it'll be frozen.
But it'll die or just not attack at all.
So
I really like this play. Just really utilizing your resources to the maximum here from Sintelol. He's going to need to, because this is a game he cannot lose if he wants to progress. And Bunny Hopper just forgotten, pretty happy, just forgotten Torch. I'm going to bank the 3-mana Fireball into the deck later on. And again,
That is a pretty sweet combo to have with your Dread Corsair. That's another benefit to saving it, is you can more flexibly do that. The Bloodsail Cultist, not a card you see in every Warrior deck, but in combination with a Pirate, causes the upgrade effect on your weapon, which would upgrade that Arcanine Reaper into a 6-3 weapon, causing 18 damage over 3 turns. And that is some Pirate power.
Yeah, that is without any additional card draw of anything like a heroic strike or a monster.
Screw card draw, we got pirates.
This is definitely all we need. So Bunny Hopper even going for the Frostbolt. So he's done as good a job as he can do so far with the removal tools he has, just keeping the minions down.
I think the Frostbolt there is quite questionable from Bunny Hopper. He may have wanted to maybe... Like, he wants to be cycling the Stalnos, and that's why he goes for it. But saving freeze effects for the face is just so important in this matchup, especially with Evolved Kobold. You're able to, you know, get so much burst damage with the Frostbolt and the Lance to be able to set up races that I think it might have been better there for Bunny Hopper to just Fireball, just so he can preserve those effects to kind of stop the beating of the Reaper. And we do see Syntolol saving the Dread Corsair for the upgrade combo here so that he can get in all of that juicy Arcanite Reaper damage. We can see in his hand that'll be, you know, 2 6 damage swings equaling 12 damage, and then an Argent Horse Rider for 2.
Yep. Kind of crazy overall, and as you said, Bunny Hopper is going to go for the Cycle, and I don't mind Doomsayer here at all.
Yeah, it's always kind of weird when to figure out when you're supposed to play Doomsayer, right? Like, you can often think that Loot Hoarder is most likely going to contest whatever minion comes out because you expect one minion to come out at a time. You oftentimes forget that they have these big tempo terms with Dread Corsair that are possible.
Yeah, it's difficult, though, because, as you said, if just, like, Upgrade and Heroic Strike come out this turn and you Doomsayer, you're like, we still done all the damage. I've not really gained anything. Mm-hmm. I don't mind the Loot Hoarder. At least I understand why Bunny Hopper's gone for it. We have the ultimate knowledge of seeing both hands. So obviously the Doomsayer would have negated a lot of additional damage this turn. Even the Flame Juggler.
Yeah, the Doomsayer would have been huge because Syntolol would have been unable to swing with the Arcanite Reaper because you'd have to save it for the upgrade effect. Yep. So he would just be one turn slower in the game. So it would act as almost an Ice Lance to the face in this scenario. So the Doomsayer would have been huge if Bunny Hopper was able to make that read, but I don't blame him for being unable to make the read. Most of the people only play against Pirate Warrior 2 times lifetime. So being unable to
figure
out...
This is the second time ever Bunny Hopper's played Pirate Warrior.
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt it if it is. Like, and these players play ladder constantly. Like, that's how uncommon the deck really is, and it's kind of difficult to adjust to those scenarios, but after they play the Arcanite Reaper, it is actually... You know, now that the more that I think about it and look at the scenario presented in front of us, it's super huge to just drop Doomsayer after Arcanite Reaper comes out just so you can limit their ability to potentially upgrade that and continue swinging it at your face.
Yep. Bunny Hopper did trade in the Thanos there. Going to follow up with the Arcane Insect because he's on the dire need of some freeze effects now that a board has suddenly appeared in front of him.
Yeah.
As, you know, regardless of the weapon threat, which is a huge threat in itself, he could just die to what's in hand from Syntolol. The board state is putting out 8 damage itself, so this is going from bad to worse. Salty deckhand, even more damage. The block will be procced, and there's not a lot Bunny Hopper can do about it in this game.
Yeah, he can proc him at 1, and he really doesn't want to have to like overkill a ton by using, you know, the Reaper Charge, but at the same time, if you don't use the Reaper Charge, that means you're using all your from hand damage, and if you use all your from hand damage, then all your opponent has to do is freeze your face in the board, and then suddenly you can't, you know, finish them off the following turn. So I think it's better to waste the Reaper, but it's a really tough call.
Well, I think the benefit is because this is only going into turn 7 for the mage, it's not as if he can freeze Alexstrasza. You know, he's got like a fair few turns. He would literally have to chain multiple freezes on face and the board to be able to survive. Like, enough turns for him to heal himself.
Some sort of freeze plus ice barrier could get really sticky really fast. But I guess you know your opponent doesn't have any freezes. Unless they just recently drew Blizzard, and if they drew Blizzard, they can't play Ice Barrier, because at the end of Bunny Hopper's turn, he had enough mana to play Frost Nova or Barrier, and he did not play Frost Nova, so you can kind of assume that he does not have Frost Nova plus Barrier there. So I do like the play from Syntolol there. I think it's a good read on the situation.
And there we go, and it is going to be Syntolol. Does get the win with the Pirate War, an extremely quick game versus Freeze Mage, but looking at the series overall, I think Bunny Hopper's still in a good position. He just has his Freeze Mage to finish up the series.
And Syntolol has the common prey of Freeze Mage. Freeze Mage in its natural habitat often feasts on the zoos, just completely devours them. You know, Sentinel has some sort of a chance. He has teched just in case, worst case, there is a freeze mage popping up out of nowhere. He has one crazed alchemist that could potentially save the day, get a huge swing turn by flipping the stats on a doomsayer, removing it from the board, and giving his zoo a chance to, you know, build up and get some damage in. But even then, it's oftentimes the freeze mage still wins, even when crazed alchemist lands on a doomsayer.
Yeah, we're going to see if Sinsol can begin or continue this comeback versus Bunny Hopper right after this. Welcome back to the continuation of the Bunny Hopper versus Sinterlol series, the second series of the day in the European Last Call tournament. And it's going to be Bunny Hopper's Freeze Mage versus Sinterlol's Zoo Warlock, and the Mid Shaman is what he has available. So he's got to win versus this Freeze Mage at some point, or with both decks, should I say, if Sinterlol wants to take the series. And looking at the lineups, it's going to be a tough one. I think Bunny Hopper, although lost a pretty rough game previously to the Pirate Warrior, still going to have a handful to try and take this Freeze Mage down.
And we see one of the tech cards already in Sinterlol's hand, the Demon Fire, which could potentially allow him to get off to maybe some sort of fast start and rush down Bunny Hopper. But it's not going to be an easy task for him. Freeze Mage is one of the highest win rate decks against Zoo Warlock in the entire game of Hearthstone. So it's going to be absolutely brutal to try and pick apart a win here. But Demon Fire, maybe buffing a minion outside of range of Frostbolt and what have you, could be a way that Sintel is able to get victory here. So we do see him keep it off the mulligan. A pretty aggressive keep here of, you know, play Flame Imp, hope it doesn't die, Demon Fire that bad boy, and take him to Pound Town.
Yeah, I think in unfavored matchups, you kind of have to take the risks, right? Mm-hmm. And you have to try and just go all out on a tactic and just hope it works. Because, as you said, Freeze Mage is kind of built to beat Zoo.
Exactly.
I think it's the one deck that the heaviest board, like, centric deck based on minions is Zoo. And then Freeze Mage is built to win those matchups. So
yeah, and Bunny Hopper has a Flame Strike in his list as well. He cut one of the ice barriers for Flame Strike, which kind of hurt him against in potentially maybe the Face Hunter matchup or other matchups like that. But it really, and against the Pirate Warrior, it kind of hurt him. But in this matchup, that extra board clear is really, really good.
Yeah, I'm going to be able to just reduce down the board later on. And oh!
That's
better than the Frostbolt.
It's interesting, though. You have Frost Nova Doomsayer, right? You do know your opponent runs Crazed Alchemist. You saw them keep two cards, so you can kind of expect one of those could potentially be Crazed Alchemist. You know one of the kept cards is the Flame Imp. So, yeah, he's saving it for the Frost Nova Doomsayer, which I think is quite risky. I think is quite safe.
Yeah.
Because if it is a Crazed Alchemist, that other kept card by Sinterlol,
you're in trouble.
They just flip that and then hit you in the face with the Flame Imp, you just get blown out. So Bunny Hopper taking the safe route here by just clearing it. Now he sees the Demon Fire get discarded, which was the other kept card, which reduces the chances of Sinterlol having the Crazed Alchemist in his hand very, very dramatically at this point.
Yeah, that's why he's playing Demon Fire. Needs to put cards in the deck that he's okay with discarding, it seems.
There you go. So at this point, I think it's quite reasonable, honestly, to just drop the Doomsayer, because none of your opponent's cards are kept cards, which means they had four draws to try and naturally draw into the Crazed Alchemist. You know, five if they tap, and the odds of them having it are greatly, you know, against them.
Mm-hmm. Just go for the ping on the library.
Yeah, he's saving it for the Frost Nova for the big board sweep combo, which is greedy. It's a little greedy, because you're giving your opponent more potential chances to try and find that Crazed Alchemist that could blow you out. But, you know, he doesn't have too many big sweepers in the midst of things, so slowing down to try and find them. You know, maybe if he had the Blizzard at the time, he would have been okay with Doomsaying, because then your opponent doesn't develop on 4, then on 5 you Frost Nova, then on 6 you Blizzard, then on 7 you Flame Strike, and then they're probably dead.
Yeah, and this is exactly what Buddy Up has got available to him going forward, which is kind of scary. Just repeat board clears, which is kind of horrible for the Zoo player here. And into Doomguard, not too terrible. Ooh. Oh. With Soulfire as well.
It's kind of awkward having all the discard cards in your hand like that, but I think it's Defender of Argus and then show him who's boss.
Yeah, why not at this point? Again, like turn 5, you're not really expecting any hard AoE anyway, so you could just go aggressive and just say, well, if you're going to freeze, you're going to freeze. There's not much you can do about it. And this is not the craziest peddler I've ever seen, to be honest, Fiber.
Well, the Stone Tusk Boar is actually 3 damage because of the Dire Wolf Alphas. You can attack with both the Dire Wolf Alphas, then put the Stone Tusk Boar in the middle and attack with that. I think the reason why Cyntalil went with this line of play is because if he does Argus the 2 Dire Wolf Alphas, it actually doesn't increase his damage output by anything because they stop buffing each other because the Argus has to be placed in the middle. So you'd have to kind of place the Argus off to one side to increase the damage by one. So,
which feels kind of weird.
Feels kind of weird, yeah.
Don't get the health benefits. It's just going to tap, though.
Yeah, going for tap. I guess he assumes that, you know, Blizzard can't come down yet. It's not turn 6. So the Dire Wolves are likely going to be left around. Probably anticipates a Frost Nova Doomsayer. So when that happens, you can still just slot in that Stone Dust Boar, push that 3 damage face. If we're looking at Cyntalil's hand right now, you got Doomguard for 5, Soulfire for 4, Stone Dust Boar for 3, and that's already up to 12 damage. So he's closing in here on a decent amount of damage to potentially be able to make something happen.
If he can discard very well. Yeah. Like that's the trick. As that said, that combo is going to be a 3-card discard. Ooh. Another Soulfire coming out. He does have the Imp that he can use to at least cycle cards with.
Yeah, he has the Imp he could cycle with, and he could go for board control here. If he goes for board control, he's going to get absolutely destroyed by this Blizzard, which is just going to kill everything. But he does have the ability here to, you know, instead of going face, use the Stone Tusk Boar plus the Soulfire to kill the Doomsayer off. Try and maintain your board, or just use the Doom Guard to kill off the Doomsayer to maintain your board. Okay. That puts a lot more pressure and helps you play around Blizzard a little bit. I like it.
Yeah, it's really nice. And like we see Cyntalil like really utilizing these double Direwolf and having the options. Even though he didn't use the boar was there as a strong option, as you said, straight away for the 3 damage. And this is not too bad either.
Yeah, guaranteed.
Can just guarantee the golem.
Clean up the Thalnos if he wants to.
No one is the boss of that imp. I never actually realized his voice line. That's kind of hilarious.
But now the second Doomguard. Holy smokes.
Even Cynth is surprised.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, into a golem as well. Why not?
This might be the zoo hand that can do it. He's got to start worrying about how much he's tapping because Bunny Hopper is playing, you know, a more burst variant of Freeze Mage with the Evolved Kobold in there. If you start tapping towards those, like, 15... 18 sort of life totals, you can just get one turn killed out of nowhere, but
this is so tense because just glancing, it looks like this is a clear flame strike because Bunny Hopper's in the position where that's a lot of damage represented. He's only on 15, he doesn't have any secrets up, but he does have Ice Lance. So he could Ice Lance the Doomguard.
And play Emperor.
And play Emperor, which then kind of forces a response and makes your Arcane Intellect cheaper next turn. Makes your Flamestrike cheaper to be able to weave in potentially a ping or something else the following turn. So I think this turn is going to be a test of Bunny Hopper's restraint.
I like your play much, much better. The Ice Lance and the Emperor Thoris. And we've seen already both Soulfires. We know there's no Power Overwhelmings in the list. So you know you're not dead, and you know your opponent has to play minions and they have to extend into Flamestrike. So you're just going to be milking way more value out of that Flamestrike. And now instead, now you have no board freezes and no board clears in your hand, and you have a clunky hand that you can't Arcane Intellect into to Blizzard with. So yep. I don't like Bunny Hopper's play there with the Flamestrike. I think it was...
And also just having Emperor down, because Emperor's just a threat in itself. Yep. Even though Zoo wants to be the aggressor and end the game quickly, if you leave Emperor up more than one turn, you can just die, no matter what health you're on. Like, that's the kind of the threat level you're under. And it's just going to clear off the 3-3 Golem. Now, here comes the Ice Lance. So the odds on him dying this turn, I think, they're impossible, right? There are no cards.
Nothing's impossible, right?
Both Soulfires are gone, both Doomguards.
Oh, he doesn't run Abusive Sergeant.
No.
We had to get Crazed Alchemist plus... Peddler into Soulfire or Power Overwhelming was lethal. So there was still like a 1 in a million.
Huh? The Doomguard's frozen.
I mean, if it wasn't frozen.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, he sets up a position which he cannot die no matter what because of the cards he's seen. Soulfire from the Peddler. Yeah.
If the Doomguard wasn't frozen, that would have been lethal right there.
Yeah.
The juggle misses both of the loot hoarders, which isn't great for Cyntalil.
Voidwalker's going to help out, though.
Yeah, that pretty much bails out the juggler there. Gets the job done.
Oof. Smog. Juggler doesn't want to mess about hitting minions. It's just face or nothing. And Cyntalil's just deciding where he's going to go with this Soulfire. And I feel like face is only the place here.
Well, this is the second Soulfire, right?
And it's the third.
And the second Peddler. So there's no more discard cards remaining in Cyntalil's deck except for Darkshire Librarian. So I think it's fine to kind of be holding on to it. And Barrier is not a bad draw, but I think you Arcane Intellect first, just in case you hit
this Frost. There's another Frost Nova, another Blizzard that you can use as well. Yeah, I think I like Intellect first.
Or, well, Loot Horde is first, actually.
Yeah,
of course.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's a pretty well-rounded turn, just getting all of that stuff down. The Arcane Intellect and the two Secrets, even, worst case. You're looking at 9 damage coming in, and you're at 16. So odds are, your opponent's got max burst out of hand of 4, because both Doomguards are gone, both Soulfires are gone, and they have a Peddler card in their hand. So you can expect maybe 6 burst if they hit 2 minions off of...
So is he just gonna go for the ice block and the barrier? Okay.
Okay.
I didn't know if, because as you were mentioning about what's been used, the barrier would have been enough, right?
The barrier would have been enough for him not to be able to get popped, because Synthalol does not run abusive sergeants, which is kind of a strange addition. Abusive sergeants got nerfed, and he decided, not good enough anymore.
Nah,
we're getting
nerfed.
These guys out of
get
here.
Out, yeah. Disenchant. Sorry, I'm done. So, not even got them in the collection.
I think, honestly, even though the decks are public, Bunny Hopper may be playing around abusive sergeant just because you expect it.
Yeah, you're so used to it.
Two,
yeah.
It's been there for 2.5 years, so it's pretty crazy that it's not in there anymore. Just one attack stat, and suddenly, not good enough.
I think it's still pretty okay, to be honest, in general. But we are going to see the attack in from Synthalol, proc the Ice Barrier, of course. No surprise, as both Secrets were played. So Synthalol has to now work out what he needs to do to finish this game. It's
He's getting progressively more
awkward.
He's too afraid of tapping into potentially... lethal ranges.
Alexstrasza is pretty big.
Yeah,
he doesn't even need to use it this turn, but in general, he still could, and there's no great answer to it.
It's an 8-8.
It is. It's definitely an 8-8.
Sometimes you just need an 8-8. He's still got the ice block up. He can set himself up to 16 life because of the armor there, and contest the Doomguard quite nicely.
As we said, there's realistically no burst left in the deck. We know there's the Soulfire there, but there's been Peddlers as well for extra Soulfires. It's like, how does he kill this? He just doesn't. Or if he trades into it, Argus is probably the best draw he could have got there to be able to force damage and not let Alexstrasza smack you in the face. But there's no way he can kill Alexstrasza, because then he just has no way to close out the game. So Argus is actually pretty huge now.
And the question is, do you play the Flame Imp? You kind of committed to not playing it by not playing it last turn and not tapping or anything, but now you're under the clock of this 8-8. Can you really afford to try and play around Burst at this point in time, or do you have to just kind of YOLO go all in?
It's just a tough one, because there's been a Frostbolt and 2 Torches played.
Two Torches have been played, a Frostbolt has been played, an Ice Lance has been played.
But no Fire... Wasn't that last game with the Fireball?
Last game, yeah. There's been no Fireballs. So
that's what's... There's Fireballs and Torches in the deck.
Yeah, there's 4 Fireballs essentially in the deck. And so he really does not want to fall down into double Fireball range, but he does go with the tap here, which is getting him into that range. And Bunny Hopper just needs a few pings, basically, at this point to be able to kill him if he has double Fireball.
Yeah, and he can't proc the block, which is huge, because now we're at the point in almost every Freeze Mage game where all the maze needs to do is just buy one more turn, done. And that's the game. So he's going to have to draw, though, because he's very minion heavy with the Kobold, the Acolyte of Pain, and the Emperor, which could have come down so long ago.
Yeah.
So long ago.
I think it would have been a much easier game had he done it that way, but he's still in a pretty great spot as long as he's able to hit a freeze effect off this Arcane Intellect. He's got 1 Blizzard, 1 Frost Nova remaining in the deck, so the odds are pretty decent for him to hit it, as his deck is very thin at this point. And even the Fireball there is good enough, right? Like, you can most... Well, actually, no, it's not. You're going to leave up 4 power with the Fireball, and that Peddler card's been sitting there for a really long time. So you're expecting it to either be Soulfire or Power of Warming at this point. So you most likely have to go with the Fireball and the Lance, and that's fine. You still have 3 more Fireballs in the deck, so you have enough burn to finish it off, and plus you're setting up Alexstrasza to be able to connect, so a Fireball off the top would then be lethal, or any freeze effect allowing Alexstrasza to connect again, because this is the second Argus, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So any freeze effect allowing Alexstrasza to connect twice would win the game. So I like Fireball on the 3-6, plus Ice Lance the 2-3. Just
Yeah, just greatly, well, almost guarantees that your block won't get procced. And, you know, yet again, worst case, he can Acolyte Ping next turn and still have some, you know, plenty of options available to him to continue the game. And plus, this is just another issue where, well, there's an 8-2 on the board. I have a 2-2. Normally, that looks like a good trade, except I'm really trying to prop this ice block soon.
Yeah, it might be time to... Is it time to commit the Flame Imp? Probably not.
Does he...
It's too low, right? You get way too close to being able to die. At that point, you die to Evolved Kobold Fireball Ping, so...
Never a good way to go.
Never a good way to go. The second ice block available for Bunny Hopper, that means... he's got extra time here, so he can just Acolyte Ping, and if he strings together two burn spells, that'll be all she wrote.
Yeah, he just managed to buy so much additional time. And, you know, the Ice Lance is probably even more card draw with the Novice Engineer. Why not? The Ice Lance early on was just MVP, but no burn available, but a Doomsayer, and which...
Heals for 7. You play that out there, most likely Syndulla is going to have to make a decision. Does he kill the Doomsayer, or does he pop the ice block?
Yeah, I mean, so let's think. There's nothing in the deck left that does instant from hand damage, right? Because there's no Horse Riders in the deck for the Zoo player. Mm-hmm. Is there another Juggler?
I think there is one more Juggler,
yeah. Okay, so Juggler's the only card that can provide any form of instant on-demand damage, and even that's going to be difficult when... you've got no other cards in hand, which forces you to tap, which then means you're just more likely to die the following turn. So this is such a close ending in the Doomsayer. This is where Syntolol is going to be asked the question of, do you think you can kill this? And if you do, it's going to buy me time one way or the other. But there's the Alchemist!
There it is.
Never mind, decision made. Alchemist, goodbye, Doomsayer. Crack on, prot the ice block. And then now he's going to put Buddy Hopper under even more pressure. But he still has his second ice block available to him, so he can still continue to buy turns to get that burst together.
There is somewhat of a question here of if you still ignore the Doomsayer and use the Crazed Alchemist to help pop without having to tap. Because tapping is very dangerous, and you could potentially pop without tapping this turn to set up for Soulfire to be lethal. So I kind of like that play to play around, you know, some sort of Fireball, Frostbolt, Ping lethals.
Yeah, this is pretty much just, you know, you need the exact damage. I can proc you with Soulfire. But we can see the second ice block available. So if he's forced to use the Soulfire in the following turn, then he's got no way to do the final one damage outside of Juggler, which is kind of hilarious. There's a Fireball, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really interesting how this is panning out and how much Syntolol is really valuing his life total. And just kind of making it as awkward as possible for Bunny Hopper to make the lethal happen here. But the second ice block is... going to be upsetting,
and you just like Emperor here, right?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
There's no good way to deal with it left.
No, you have to ping the 1-1. You have to ping the 1-1. I would ping the 1-1 and develop the Evolved Kobold. You do not want the 1-1 just procking your ice block. You want to force them to use Soulfire or what have you to get through the ice block to make it as difficult as possible, or have to develop a minion into it.
To be honest, I forgot there was the Possessed Villager on the board before the Doomsayer. That was like looking at the Councilman and the Doomsayer. There was a lot going on. The Villager was just chilling under my notice. But yeah, you of course do not want the ice block pinged. And Imp Gang Boss, not going to do too much. See here, Evolve Kobold with the +2 spell damage. Super powerful minion overall. And Syntolol is going to be able to proc the ice block with the Soulfire.
He's not dead on board. There's 8, 9, 10, 11 damage. He's been really keeping his life total high, and that could allow him to squeeze out a victory here,
there
but
it
not
is.
Quite. The torch
it was
is drawn.
Only a matter of time, to be honest. Bunny Hopper went so long without drawing any burn, and that is going to be it. Bunny Hopper moves on to the semifinals. They're going to be facing RDU. That's going to be a fantastic semifinals, but commiserations Syntolol. He had some rough games with the Pirate Warrior, but overall, I think Bunny Hopper just played extremely well, very consistent, and the Freeze Mage... having that as the last deck versus what was left of Syntolol, it was going to be a very rough road for him to be able to take the games versus Bunny Hopper he needed to.
Yeah, the Freeze Mage surprisingly had very good matchups in this series and was a great deck choice for him. Just being able to line up so well against the Zoo and being able to line up so well against the Midrange Shaman. Not a lot of players bringing Zoo to this tournament, but RDU is one of the other players, or the only other player bringing Zoo to this lineup, so you have to expect... pretty happy about his Freeze Mage decision.
It seems to be paying off so far. But to give you some more thoughts on that series, we have Sottl and Savit standing by.
Thank you, Raven. And yeah, what a crazy series, particularly that last game. That was one of the weirdest Zoo versus Freeze Mage games that I've ever seen. It went so long and there's so many strange interactions between cards, but really, really strong series and a lot of like new archetypes that we saw as well, showing that perhaps the nerf had quite an impact on people's decisions to come to this tournament.
Yeah, there were a lot of small decisions there and to be made in the last one, especially like that. And Zindalol skipping the tap on turn 7 and then tapping every turn afterwards, it felt pretty weird. But Bunnyhopper is moving on and Freeze Mage is back, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, it just seems to never go away. It just keeps coming back and very strong deck and it's going to be strongest RDU. RDU will have the option to ban it in the semifinals if it chooses to.
Yep, RDU is going to be having that Zoo deck as well, which is one of the big matchups. But here you can see some of the highlights from the series. Freeze Mage being played from both sides, aggressive hunters and pirate warriors, and just all kinds of crazy stuff going on in this series. As it looked like it was going to end fairly quickly due to all the aggressive decks, but then suddenly the Freeze Mages came out and started to drag things out a little bit longer. But Sintel already struggled to get a win with that pirate warrior for a while.
Yeah, the draws were so inconsistent. Like the draws he had in the first two games were abysmal, and in the last one he just like pretty much threw the nuts in the third one with that. And it is a very powerful deck, but personally I don't like it very much because it does really, you're so dependent on the draws, and there's very little kind of room to be making plays. If you get a hand that makes you skip turn two, for example, you lose so much tempo, but it's hard to recover.
Yeah, I think the real story here is that, you know, these two twin brothers separated at birth, you know, brought back together by Hearthstone. I think that's a really big deal and such a lovely story for the game as a whole. But we have some more matches coming up very